So if you are struggling with the performance of your game, chances are it's not as optimized as it should be. Today, we'll be going over 7 ways to optimize your Godot game for better performance, starting with tip number 1, use static typing over dynamic typing. I make use of static typing whenever possible, not only for its performance boost alone, also because static typing helps the engine make better use of its memory, check types faster, give you auto completion and documentation, early error detection, and a more structured code. I mean, I don't see a reason why not to use static typing, but here's an example that shows you how long it takes to perform the same task using static typing and dynamic typing. And from the results, you can see that the static type runs faster by 18% than the dynamic type. Tip number 2, use the Visibility Notifier node. And this trick can actually have quite the impact on your game performance. When you attach a visibility notifier to objects like your player, enemies, NPC or projectiles, they only get rendered when they are within the camera's view. And this reduces the workload on the engine, therefore improving the overall performance of your game. All you need to do is just add a visibility notifier as a child of the object you want to monitor. And that's it. For more details, check out the video on Sabia Games or Channel GD Quest, link in the description. Tip number 3, disabling the VSYNC property. Disabling VSYNC can potentially boost your game performance by reducing input lags and increasing frame rate. However, it can also lead to screen tearing where you see fragments of multiple frames on the screen simultaneously. Now, disabling VSYNC isn't always the best choice for every game. If you are working on a fast-paced action game or if your game relies heavily on visuals, then disabling VSYNC probably isn't a good idea. It's also worth noting that different hardware setup can behave differently with VSYNC disabled. Consider offering an in-game option to toggle VSYNC, giving players control over their experience. Tip number 4, cleaning your code. And now I know, cleaning isn't exactly the most exciting topic, but trust me when I say it's important. And this actually takes me back to a friend project I worked on. So basically, he had performance issue with a hack and slash game he was working on. And holy cow, you need to see this dude's sentry. With the numbers of nodes he had, you probably think he was starting a node farm. But anyways, you get the point. Just take a little time to tidy up your code, remove any unused scripts, nodes, or assets to streamline your project and improve performance. Tip number 5, optimizing your enemies. Now, let's say you've got over 50 enemy AI in your game, or using Godot's navigation algorithm to find the shortest path to your player character. Sounds the same, right? Well, that's because it is. The thing is, at every physics frame, each enemy is trying to calculate the shortest path to the player, which puts a lot of stress on the CPU. One approach to optimizing this is to group enemies together and have them share a path instead of each enemy calculating its own path. This approach is commonly used in RTS games like Age of Empire or tower defense games like Kingdom Rush. Another trick is to reduce how often the enemy calculates their path. Instead of doing it every frame, you can spread out the calculation over time. And this idea was actually inspired by a video I came across by Blackgeese. Be sure to check it out. Video link is also in the description. Tip number 6, use baked lightning. Real-time lightning shadows especially can be quite costly, especially in scenes with many light sources. This can lead to slower frame rate and put a lot of pressure on your hardware, which impacts performance. To reduce the load on your GPU, consider using baked lightning, especially if you're working on a mobile game. This can look amazing, with the only trade-off being it won't look dynamic, meaning changes in lighting conditions during gameplay won't be reflected in real time. However, sometimes this is a trade-off actually worth making. Tip number 7, occlusion culling. Occlusion culling is a technique used to improve the rendering performance by not drawing objects that are visible to the camera. This puts less work on the engine and improves the performance of your game. To use occlusion culling, enable use occlusion culling in the project setting. In your scene, add an occluder instance 3D. There are two methods to setting up occluders for your scene. First is manually placing occluders in your scene. Second is automatically baking occluders. just select the occluder instance 3D node, then click bake occluders at the top of the 3D viewport. After baking, the occluder instance 3D should contain an occluder 3D resource that stores a simplified version of your object's geometry. If you have any other optimization techniques, please let me know in the comments. Thanks for watching. See ya.